is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your podcast co-host. We have an awesome topic for you this week. You might have seen the title, but if not, here it is. How to achieve 10% plus growth every year. Well, sounds kind of bold, but we're going to show you how to do that. Hey, before we get to that content of that podcast episode, I have a couple announcements to make. The first is an announcement regarding an upcoming Thriving Dentist Masterclass. This is coming up on August 25th, about a month from the time that this episode airs. And that masterclass, the masterclasses are 3 hours long. It allows us to go into a deep dive on a particular topic. You're going to like this topic. It's a specific plan to reduce your overhead to 60% or less. That's August 25th, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern time. Very affordable, less than $100. Come join us on that. You can find that. You can register for that masterclass at thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. And you'll receive 3 hours of CE credits for attending that masterclass. The next announcement that I have is we have another top clinical tip. This tip is from Dr. Bianco Vallejo, and it's all about facial injectables. She shares some great information about facial injectables and about whether it might be appropriate to add this as a service in your practice. Now, you do need to check with your state board. It's allowed in some states and not allowed in others, so you would need to check with that. But in the meantime, Dr. Bianco Vallejo shares some great information in this top clinical tip.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Bianco Vallejo. I'm the owner of Green Valley Smiles Dentistry, which is a PDS-supported practice in Henderson, Nevada, and I'm also the creator of Oral Health Minute, which is an educational and entertaining video series on my Instagram page at Dr. Bianco Vallejo. And my clinical tip today is I'm going to be talking about facial injectables. Why? Because there is a heightened focus on aesthetics and facial injectables in the entire world right now. And I really thank the Kardashians for that. And, you know, I'll share with you this. When I first started administering facial injectables back in 2016, I had a sign in my office that says, ask me about Botox. And you wouldn't believe, and I still to this day, how many patients ask me if I can make their lips look bigger like Kylie Jenner. And that's because there's this misunderstanding. People think that Botox make your lips look bigger. And so my tips for today are really to help you understand what the two main facial injectables that dentists can administer and the applications, so you can better educate your patients, but also to see if this is something that you'd like to take next steps, become certified on, and help administer with your patients. So let's get started. There are two main types of wrinkles, dynamic wrinkles and static wrinkles, okay? So at this point, go ahead and grab a mirror or turn on selfie mode of your cell phone camera, and I want you to make a couple of facial expressions. Go ahead and smile real big, okay? And then go ahead and make an angry face, pretend like you smelled something really sour or foul, and go ahead and make a surprised face, okay? As you can make those emotions, you'll see as the muscles contract, these wrinkles will form on your face, okay? Those are dynamic wrinkles. They also fade once the emotion passes and your face goes blank, that you no longer see them, okay? Common dynamic wrinkles as you went through those emotions include the frown lines between the eyebrows, forehead wrinkles, crow's feet along the eye lines or smile lines, okay? And the next wrinkle that we're going to talk about is called static wrinkles, okay? So static wrinkles remain on the face even after our facial muscles relax and tend to deepen with age. And this is because as you age, collagen production declines and causes the skin to lose elasticity. So examples of these static wrinkles include lines at the corner of the mouth, across the cheek, okay, along the neck, right? Those nasolabial folds, those parentheses along your mouth. Okay, and also because of the natural aging process, It's very common for these dynamic wrinkles to turn into static wrinkles, right? So you might be looking at yourself at rest. You're not making an angry face, but you can see those 11s in between your eyebrows, okay? And when it comes to facial injectables, just like there are two types of wrinkles, there are two main types of facial injectables that we use in dentistry: botulinum toxin and dermal fillers. And these are the two top non-surgical cosmetic procedures performed in the United States, which is why dentists are, it makes sense for us to get involved in this trend. And botulinum toxin injections and dermal filler injections are so safe, quick acting, have very few side effects, and easy to administer. It's totally in the wheelhouse of our scope of practice as dentists, since we are experts in the head and neck and are very comfortable giving injections every day and are so in tune with facial harmonies and aesthetics of the face. And so botulinum toxin works on dynamic wrinkles, okay? So what the botulinum toxin does is it prevents the release of acetylcholine from the motor nerve endings, and this causes a temporary paralysis of the muscle, okay? So if you're not able to contract that muscle, then you're not able to make that angry face or that, you know, surprised face. And then the wrinkle doesn't form, and then our skin's natural regenerative properties are going to fill in the line over time, okay? And when it comes to the static wrinkles, that's where the dermal fillers really work best. Anywhere that you've lost volume, right, like those parentheses, those nasolabial folds around your mouth, or anywhere that you want to add volume, like thin lips sagging cheekbones, that's where the dermal fillers come into place. What's great, and as dentists, I highly recommend starting to inject with these, temporary fillers that last 6 months to a year, and the effects of the Botox last about 3 to 6 months, which perfectly coincide with the dental recall appointments. So as you can see, there are multiple ways that dentists can administer this in their practice. It's truly a practice builder. Patients are calling me asking, they can't wait for their next recare appointment, making sure that I have Botox in stock or dermal fillers in stock, so that way we can do that at their recare appointments. And it's been really, really wonderful. So if you're interested in learning how to administer this in your practice, then definitely go to your state board website to find out what is the criteria to become certified. So that way you can take advantage of this great new trend in dentistry and the world. So I'm Dr. Bianca Velayo. I hope you enjoyed your clinical tip, and please follow me on Instagram at dr.biancavallejo.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host. Today's topic is how to achieve 10% plus growth every year. How to achieve 10% plus growth every year. Gary, I have a question for you. One of the things that fascinated me when we first met is you made a comment, 5-6 years ago, that you haven't missed a single year and you have been growing double digits, meaning your Life Smiles practice every single year from the day you bought it. In some cases, I guess in the first year, you double the practice, so you grow 100%. But even since then, you continue to grow double digits year after year. And my question to you, Gary, is this like a fluke, or is this something that's happening only because you are there, or is this something that can happen in every practice?
Yeah, Naren, I think it's a fair question. And the truth is, we have experienced double-digit percentage growth each and every year. Every year has been a new best year, even 2020, when we were faced with being shut down for over 7 weeks. We finished 2020 above 2019, which didn't look very likely at the start of the pandemic. But we actually have achieved double-digit percentage. You know, double-digit, let's define that from simply a math definition. 10% or more would constitute double-digit growth. 9 is a single digit. 10 is a double digit. So we're saying that you can grow your practice at least 10% each and every year. And Naren, I was curious about whether we could actually engineer this in my client base. And I am really pleased to report that we've discovered that you can actually engineer this. We're doing it now in my coaching work. We call it the 10% challenge. And we have created a methodology with each of our clients to strive towards 10% or more growth every year. And the great news is we are seeing the vast, vast majority of our clients achieve this.
Absolutely. I second that, Gary, because you have given me the opportunity to listen into some of the mastermind sessions you have. And one of the things the team, your team prepares is kind of a report on how each practice does. And like month after month, you know, consistently, there are practices that are growing 25%, 30%. Yeah. I mean, 10% is like the low end of the spectrum.
I'll add to that. And in some cases, these were practices that have been plateaued, been in a plateau. You know, if you graph practice growth, the history of a practice, let's say a doctor owns his or her practice for 30 years, and you graph it every year, it doesn't look like a straight line linear graph that maybe is going up at, you know, like at an angle. It doesn't look like that. What most practices look like when they track their growth over a period of time, it looks like a set of stairs. So in other words, they grow, then plateau, then grow and plateau, grow and plateau. And there's often certain touch points that caused the growth. Maybe they added an associate. Maybe they added a part-time specialist. Maybe they built a new building. So it looks more like a set of stairs. Now, you're pretty math-oriented, Darren. Does that make sense to you?
Absolutely. And that's very true. Like it's like a set of stairs. You grow and then you stay flat. And sometimes it even starts declining because your expenses continue to grow. And if your dollar amount doesn't really change, you are in decline. And I've seen that so many times.
Yeah. And I'm a firm believer that practices are growing or they're dying. And given those two choices, we want to be growing. So we put together in preparation for this coaching and action segment, 8 very specific strategies that will allow you to achieve 10% or more growth every year. Can I dive into those 8 specific strategies?
Absolutely, Gary. Yes.
All right. Number one, it's simply begin with the end in mind. Set the goal by looking at your best year. Go back and look at history over your best year. Whatever that number is, multiply it by 1.1. So let's say your best year, I'm going to use round numbers, Naren, just to make it easy to show an example. Yes. Let's say your best year was $1 million. Then we're simply going to multiply $1 million by 1.1, and the answer now becomes a $1.1 million practice. Now divide that by 12 in order to get your monthly goal. Does that make sense, Naren?
Yes.
So again, in this example, divided by 12, that means you need to collect $91,666 in order each month in order to achieve that 10% growth that year. So number one, begin with the end in mind by actually setting the goal. Now, number two, let me get very tactical here. I want you to assign a specific team member to be your doctor scheduling coordinator, Now, she'll be one of your administrative team members and she'll have other responsibilities as well. But I want you to assign one team member that's your doctor scheduling coordinator. Other team members can schedule, but I want your doctor's team member scheduling coordinator to be responsible for your schedule, And that's something that is a departure from the way most practices work, Naren. If a practice has two front desk team members, they often have different duties, but there isn't one. They both do doctor scheduling. And if they have more than two, it might be three. You know, they all do doctor scheduling. But what I found is that if they're all doing it, complete that sentence, Naren.
Nobody's doing it. Going back to your coaching, I think the magic of your coaching program, especially the practice management support, is making all these things happen day in and day out. Like, yeah. You know, doctors, once the practice is busy, they are focused on providing the best care to the patient. So like removing that hat of being the best dentist you can be and wearing the hat of the best manager is tricky. So that's why you have this yo-yo, or like you call the stair type growth. They grow and then they stagnate. Mm-hmm. But what you do, I think, at Life Smiles is you are the business guy. And for your clients, same thing. You know, your team is the business team. And they just make sure these things are humming along.
Right, right. Well, and then, you know, I want to be really granular about this. I want your doctor scheduling coordinator to know that her number one priority is scheduling you to goal. Not just scheduling, but scheduling you to goal. Everything else that she does has a lower priority than that. And doctor, you've got to back that up in providing her resources to be able to do this. But everything else has a lower priority. Because if you have an opening in your schedule and it doesn't get filled, it's like the vacant seat on the airplane. You know, if that seat doesn't get filled and that plane takes off, then the airline's forever lost the opportunity for revenue in that seat. So same with your schedule. If you have a 2 o'clock opening tomorrow afternoon and no one's working on it and 2 o'clock comes around tomorrow and it isn't filled, you will forever lose that opportunity. So it's by doing this, by assigning a specific doctor scheduling coordinator, you're helping direct her priorities, which leads me to the third strategy. Assign a specific team member to be your hygiene scheduling coordinator. You know, in a thriving practice, 1/3 of your total practice production comes from hygiene. So, Naren, if we ignore that, then we're ignoring 1/3 of the opportunity in your practice.
100%. And the other thing I think I like about the hygiene focus is the doctor doesn't have to work to bring in that money, you know, to bring in that revenue. Right. So let's say in $1 million practice, 1/3 is 333,000. That's a lot. I mean, for a larger practice, a $2 million practice, that's 666,000. That adds up.
It reduces the burden that the dentist feels to have to be, you know, to carry the production burden themselves on his or her shoulders.
Also, it builds a relationship, right? Now the patients are checking in every 6 months where you have opportunities to say, hey, you need this, so here is an idea. You know, it creates opportunities for the dentist to have conversations.
In the same way that I suggest that your doctor scheduling coordinator understand that her number one priority is scheduling Dr. DeGaul, the number one priority of your hygiene scheduling coordinator, it's a little different, same concept, but a little bit different, is to fill 92% or more of the available hygiene appointments. 92% or more. Notice I didn't say 100%, Naren. 100% is not realistic. It simply is not, you know, reflective of real life. However, 92% or more would be an A on the report card. And it's not easy. It's not easy to do that. But 92% or more would be an A on the report card. Now, let's add some more texture to this. I would suggest that each of those team members have an individual bonus relative to their responsibilities. So the doctor scheduling coordinator, I suggest that you set up a monthly bonus that if she achieves 100% of your goal with kept appointments, they have to be kept, they can't be just scheduled, they have to show up, then she will receive X bonus. And I'll let you decide what that dollar amount is, but that might be $250. I'm just making up a number, but you're welcome to plug in your own. Now, that would be the level one bonus. But level two would, if she achieves another 10% above and beyond that, she's going to have a level two bonus where we're going to double the bonus. So instead of $250, it becomes $500. Now think about that for a minute, Naren. I now have a partner in a team member that hopefully is as interested in doing this as you are.
You know, that might be the magic, because I know one of the things that people are thinking in the back of their mind is, oh, it's going to be more work to me. But you're saying not really. It's going to be, we all going to carry the load.
Now, let's do the same thing with the hygiene schedule coordinator. Here's what I would suggest, level one and level two. If she's at 92% or above of filled hygiene appointments, she gets a $250 bonus. If she's at 95% or more, she gets a $500 bonus. By the way, both of those bonuses will pay for themselves. They will pay for themselves in the form of increased production. They literally pay for themselves. So that, by creating those incentives, we're now aligning your goals with the goals of your team members. Now let me go to strategy number four. revisit scheduling fundamentals of rock, sand, and water. Rock, sand, and water. And that's the idea of having specific types of appointments every day in your schedule. Rocks represent the major production. Sand is minor production. And water is non-production or very low production. And Darren, one of the things we can do with our listeners is put a link to the episode we did all about scheduling fundamentals. Let's make sure we put that in the links in the show notes for this particular episode.
Absolutely. Great idea.
Yeah. So if you'll scroll down, if you go to thrivingdentist.com and simply scroll down on this particular episode, then you will see a link to that podcast we did all about the fundamentals. And really what rock, sand, and water is all about is using scheduling blocks so that you block your production, your rocks, you block those in your schedule so you make sure they happen each and every day, each and every day. Now, at the time that we're publishing this episode, late July in 2021, we have all of our rocks in the schedule for the rest of 2021. And Naren, believe it or not, we have those rocks in our schedule for all of 2022. No, we don't have specific appointments attached to those, but the rock in the schedule as the block means that we're going to work to fill those with the appropriate types of appointments. So it's no longer, this is engineering your schedule instead of it being left to chance. This is all about engineering your schedule. Now, number five, you know, we don't just wish this. It's not just don't worry, be happy, Naren. Remember that song, Don't Worry, Be Happy?
Yes.
This is not just don't worry, be happy, but number five, announce in the morning huddle what you have scheduled that day to your goal. So it might sound like, hey guys, we've got a great day ahead of us. We are actually scheduled about $2,000 above goal today. If everything holds in the schedule today, it'll be another day where we've achieved our goal. Or it might be, hey guys, we need a little help today. We're about $1,200 below goal. If that's the case, then you're going to look at opportunities to add same day dentistry in to be able to meet that goal. Now that leads me to step number six or strategy number six. Embrace same day dentistry when below goal. Embrace it. Every day we can have the opportunity to add some minor procedures. Very often, Naren, a practice is one or two minor procedures away from achieving goal. And they could be very easily added to the schedule if we just focus on it and if we're intentional about it.
Makes total sense, Kenny.
Strategy number seven. I'd encourage you, as you start this, have a weekly review meeting with your scheduling coordinators. Very short meeting. This is 10 minutes or less, and not a long meeting. And you simply look at the week that you just completed. So maybe you do this at the end of the week. Look at the week you just completed. Do this with the doctor scheduling coordinator and do it with hygiene as well. And take a look at what worked and what didn't work during the week, because you can give her real-time feedback on things she can do to become a more effective scheduler by looking at your past performance. This is kind of like the football coach, the college football coach, looking at game film to see what did we do well, what could we do better. So it's a weekly review meeting, and I would do this weekly maybe for the first 4 to 6 weeks. Once things are starting to fire on all cylinders, you can cut that back. You can do it every other week. But in the beginnings, have some frequency so you can give close to real-time feedback. You know, it's not daily, so it's not actually real-time, but it's close to real-time. It's fresh enough to where they can remember it. And do that for a while, you know, until you start to develop these habits. Now, strategy number eight may be the secret sauce that makes this all work. Appreciate team members. Look for opportunities to appreciate team members. You know, team members in dentistry, this has been proven many, many times by survey after survey. You know, what is the one thing you want to see more of in your practice? And it actually isn't money. Money is in the top five, Naren, but it's not number one.
Right.
Number one is appreciation and recognition. Those two are listed simultaneously as number one. Appreciation and recognition. So look for opportunities to appreciate your team members. For example, you know, we talked about that morning huddle, and we talked about what to do if you're below goal. And let's say one of your team members, one of your hygienists, identified unscheduled treatment for one of her hygiene patients, and you were able to move that patient after their hygiene appointment over to your side of the schedule and complete some unscheduled treatment, helping the patient and allowing your practice to hit the daily goal. Recognize your hygienist for that. Recognize your doctor scheduling coordinators for being able to schedule the goal. Recognize your hygiene scheduling coordinator for filling 92% or more of your available hygiene appointments. Recognize the role that your sterilization assistant does to keep your instruments sterilized, ready to go, so you can add in same-day dentistry. I mean, the list, Naren, is almost endless in terms of what we could recognize team members for if we're just intentional and paying attention to it. And that becomes literally like an accelerator to make all of these things happen. What do you think, Naren?
I love it, Gary. I love it. I think what I really like is, you know, you have clearly laid out the eight things you do with your coaching clients and what your virtual support team does to make sure all these eight things are happening. I think we all know what to do, but the tricky part is doing it day in and day out. And I think that's your skill set in being able to kind of figure out what to do and then making sure it happens day in and day out. And you make things look so easy. Like, it's kind of crazy. I've seen, you know, clients of yours who have grown so much, and they're telling us, you know, that they're not working as, you know, even one half as hard as they did before. In other words, they're enjoying the dentistry. They're having fun with it. It's not, doesn't feel stressful anymore. It's just, hey, this is fun, you know, which is a totally different, you know, mindset and play the game from.
I'm going to add a couple more comments here. As you're introducing this to your team members, think about a talking point that becomes like a big umbrella around all of this. And the talking point that I want you to emphasize to your team is growth allows you to help more patients. So this is very patient-centric. So growth allows us to help more patients. And the reason why that is so important is that will become a rallying point for your team members. Your team members, by virtue of, you know, I've been in over 2,200 practices as a coach. Team members may, in fact, be motivated financially, but often their number one driver is helping others. So if you can frame all of this under the umbrella of growth helps us help others, it becomes a very noble project. It becomes something that's bigger than themselves. And for many team members, they want to be part of that. Now, the other comment that I want to make has to do with your scheduling coordinators, your doctor scheduling coordinator and your hygiene scheduling coordinator. One of the things that I have learned is that oftentimes team members will have great intentions, but they get distracted, especially at the front desk. And they get distracted by the phones, incoming phone calls. They get distracted by checking people in and checking them out. So we got to check people in, we have to check them out. Now, all those things have to happen. But here's what I want you to do. This is a game changer in your practice. Let's say you have a two-person front. One is a doctor scheduling coordinator and the other is a hygiene scheduling coordinator. At any given time, one of those team members may need to excuse themselves from the front desk to put their head down and actually work on filling the doctor's schedule or work on filling the hygiene schedule. Give them permission to go to their coworker and say, hey, I need about 45 minutes to work on doctor's schedule later this week. Are you okay up here? Now, remember that you want to create a spirit of cooperation, and your team member is going to want to cooperate because she'll probably need that same help herself sometime. But make it okay for them to excuse themselves from the front desk. There's probably somewhere in your office, we have a back front office where they can go and they're away from the firing lines of phones and checking people in and checking them out, where they can actually work on these projects proactively, work on it. You know, I've always told my doctor scheduling coordinator, we have two doctor scheduling coordinators because of having two doctors. I've always said, if you've done everything you can to schedule doctor to goal, and it doesn't happen, I'm okay with that. That's just, things happen. However, if you come to me and I say, you know, can you explain what happened in terms of scheduling doctor to goal today? Oh, I just didn't have time to work on it. I'm not okay with that. Because that means we have displaced priorities. So that last tip about allowing them to excuse themselves from the front desk with the cooperation of their team members so they can put their head down and work on it is going to go a long way towards making sure that they achieve that doctor scheduling goal or that hygiene scheduling goal. Well, I took a look ahead. We've got some great questions from our listeners. So stay tuned. We're about to go into the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. We've got four questions that'll help put some texture on this coaching in action segment.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. This is Naren, your co-host. I have four questions for you, Gary. Let me start with the very first one. I remember a time when we used scheduling blocks, but for some reason we got away from it. How can I start using scheduling blocks again when we have been away from it for so long?
Naren, I don't know who it was that introduced scheduling blocks, you know, in the schedule. Maybe it was Linda Miles. Linda, many of us will recognize as one of the pioneers in dental coaching. Maybe it was Linda, but scheduling blocks used to be kind of part of the vernacular. And Naren, if I had a $50 bill, for every time a dentist has said, you know what, I used to use scheduling blocks and I don't know what happened, but they disappeared. They evaporated. If I had a $50 bill from every time I've heard that, I would own an island in the Caribbean next to Richard Branson's, except my island would be much bigger. So doctor, take solace in the fact that what you described is very common. You need to get these blocks back in place in your schedule. Now, one of the things happening right now, talk about timeliness in these questions. As we're recording this and you're listening to this, most practices are experiencing demand and healthy demand where they are scheduled well out in the future. So this can actually be a speed bump for you because you look at your schedule and you don't have anywhere to put blocks in. But I would just encourage you, just go out as far as you need to go out. You may need to go out 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks out. Those 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks is going to get here anyway, Naren. They're either going to get here with blocks in it or not. So you might as well put those blocks in it. So just go out and put in rock blocks. If you're new at the production blocks, if you're new to this, I see this is just everyday general dentistry. I suggest every day putting in an hour and a half block and two other 1 hour blocks. Now, if you add those up, that's 3.5 hours of major production going into those time slots. An hour and a half block and 2 1-hour blocks. Now, again, all that can be customized if this is something you're more familiar with already and you can tweak the time lengths. But there's 3.5 hours. And if you schedule it properly, let your team members know what procedures can go in those blocks. And only certain procedures can go in there. And then put them out in the schedule. And now look at different times of the day to put those blocks in case the patient needs an early morning, in case the patient likes a mid-morning, likes an early afternoon, likes a late afternoon. Put an assortment of those in there so we have a rock block to accommodate virtually every patient. The other blocks that you should have in your schedule are your new patient blocks. The doctor part of the new patient appointment. In our case, that's 30 minutes. And we see 3 new patients a day. So in addition to the 3 rock blocks, we've got 3 30-minute new patient blocks. And again, add that up. That's another hour and a half. So 3.5 hours. Plus an hour and a half is 5 hours. That means in the other 3 hours, you can schedule whatever you want. It doesn't matter what you schedule. If you schedule your rocks appropriately and you schedule your new patient appointments, you're going to achieve that goal. So there's a little primer on rock, sand, water. And doctor, if your team hasn't been doing this, you may have to take the lead on this and sit down with them and say, hey, let's go out. Let's see. It's the end of July. Let's look at the end of August. Let's look into September. Let's look into October, and let's put the blocks in there. And now we have the time to work toward those blocks so that we can have a more engineered schedule instead of the haphazard peaks and valleys that so many practices experience.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the second question. I must confess, I'm intrigued by creating practice growth. I love being able to grow 10% or more every year, like LifeSmiles has. But I am apprehensive. My practice feels like it's very stressful right now. Won't growth make it even more stressful?
Now, on the surface, logically, you would think that a bigger practice would be more stressful. A more productive practice would be more stressful. And actually, what we found, not only in my own practice, but we found this in our coaching work, that the opposite can be very true. The opposite can be, it's very counterintuitive. It's counterintuitive. But actually, a more productive practice can be significantly less stressful than a less productive practice. And on the surface, it doesn't make sense.
Absolutely, Gary. You know, I was just thinking of a few of your clients, and not just one, but three I'm thinking of. One particular practice, you know, he was doing, I think, 1.4 million and or something like that before he became a client. And then after working with you, he started growing 30%, and he is having the time of his life. You know, he is enjoying himself. He's actually enjoying dentistry. He's enjoying his team. So appreciative of all the people he has.
I'm thinking of who that is, and we won't name him, but I'm thinking of who that is. And I guarantee if I would have come out of the gate and said, you know what, we can grow your practice 30%. He would have shook his head. No. I want to grow, Gary, but that 10% is going to be just fine. And no, 30% would have me, you know, like pulling my hair out, you know, and that's, you know, that's really interesting. You know, my first experience of this was before I owned my own practice, Darren. And this was the client that inspired me to create our new patient experience. So this client of mine had an amazing practice, just an incredible world-class, top 1% practice. But he was plateaued. He had been plateaued for 4 years in a row, 4 years in a row. At a plateau. And he was frustrated because he felt like the language he used to me, he says, Gary, I feel like there's more gas in the tank, but I can't figure out how to access it. and it was really when I evaluated his practice, it was his new patient exams and his hygiene exams that needed to be radically changed. And he was open to it. And he asked me, as we worked on this new patient experience, he asked me, you know, Gary, what kind of result do you think we might expect? And remember, this is a top 1% already. It's almost like a world-class, how much faster can a world-class athlete become? You know, you take couch potato, someone that's never done any activity, and you start getting them out there doing things, you can see radical improvement. But what do you do with a world-class athlete that's already top 1%? So I had to be careful in answering that question because I didn't want to create false expectations. And I said, you know, I really feel confident that we can achieve 10% growth. By the way, this was a practice that in the year 2000 was producing and collecting $2 million. Mm. That was owner doctor, young associate doc right out of school, and a strong hygiene department. And that would have been a top 1% practice in the year 2000. And he said, wow, Gary, 10%. He was pretty good at math. He said, that would be 2.2. I'd feel really good about that because we've been stuck at 2 million the last 4 years. Well, as we introduce this new patient experience, this practice in the next 12 months, that's the only thing we changed was a new patient experience. Same team, same hours, same fees, same everything else. This practice produced and collected $3 million. Maybe I've intrigued some of our listeners to learn more about that new patient experience. but that was 50% growth.
Yeah.
You know, to go from two to three is 50% growth. And if If you would have asked me, did this practice have 50% growth potential? I would have said no. No. And in fact, that's what we achieved. So, and the coolest thing is afterwards, he said, Gary, I'm thrilled with the economics, of course, but you know what I'm even more thrilled with? I'm enjoying dentistry more.
Mm.
I feel less stressful and I'm doing more of the kind of dentistry I love to do.
Right.
So there's an example with 50% growth. It actually felt less stressful than it did before.
Absolutely, Gary. And I think I'm just thinking of the other two also. I mean, same story. One person is now spending more time with his family, brought in an associate, but the practice is just killing it. You know, like so the idea that growth means you have to sacrifice and be stressed out, you don't believe in it.
No, I really don't. And really, I think the key to all of it is that while our doctors are the workhorses when it comes to the production of the practice, it's a team effort that gets us there. You know, in the goal, you know, we talked about in the coaching in action that we want 1/3 of the production coming from hygiene, but that still means that 2/3 are coming from our doctor or our doctors. And there's no denying that. That's how the economics work out. But when there's an entire team that is all moving in the same direction, you know, kind of think of like we've got 16 full-time team members at LifeSmile, 19 if you include Paul, Tim, and I. It's like 19 all sitting together in the same boat, rowing in the same direction.
Right.
In many practices, Naren, they're not even in the same boat. We got some over here on the beach. They're not even in a boat. We got one in a boat that's going one way, a bunch in a boat that's going the other way, and we got a boat that's sinking somewhere. All right, I'm being figurative here, but you get the idea. It's the idea of getting everyone in the same boat rowing in the same direction.
I get it. Gary, if somebody is interested in growth and they want to grow without adding stress, would you mind having a conversation with them, maybe having a coaching strategy meeting with them, Gary?
Oh, I'd love to do that, Naren. In fact, that's set up in our work, my work with potential clients. We'll put a link in the show notes. If you just click that link, you see my scheduler and you can just schedule a time. It'll be an hour Zoom meeting. The purpose of that Zoom meeting is for me to get to know your practice. I'll share with you a little bit about our coaching to see if there's a good fit. Nothing makes me happier than to get practice doctors on a growth trajectory, that leads them to a practice that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. So yes, I would love that. And just like we teach you to always make room for new patients, we do the same thing in my coaching work. We have accommodation for new clients. I'd love the opportunity to work with you if that was your wish.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the third question. I'm concerned that practice growth will create more overhead. Your thoughts?
Mm. So maybe that doctor had a personal experience of growing the practice and not making any more money, not making any more income. That's true of a lot of practices. If that's the case, then you're growing the wrong way. Let me give you I don't mean to be just a quick answer to this. I want to provide a detailed answer. Every practice that's listening to this, every practice can grow $100,000 a year with two disclaimers. You ready for the disclaimers, Naren?
Yes.
Same team and same hours.
Mm.
Now it's strategic growth. So it's not just growth, but it's strategic growth. Same team. Same hours, same team, same hours. Look at the economics of that for just a minute. Fixed versus variable expenses. All your fixed expenses stay the same.
Same team, same hours.
That's the nature of a fixed expense. It stays the same no matter what. Your ADA dues are the same whether you produce $800,000 a year or 1.6. It's the same. Your variable expenses will go up as a function of doing more dentistry. There's really only two variable expenses in dentistry. If it's same team, same hours. The variable expenses are lab, if you use an outside lab. Now, let me use a budget percentage for that. 8% if you don't have CEREC. And when I use the percentage, it's a percent of revenue, not a percent of your expenses. So in other words, when you do more dentistry, 8% of that growth will go to pay the lab bill. If you do have CEREC, that budget's now 4% because you'll be doing some of those in-house. The second variable expense that is a function of how much dentistry you do is your consumable supplies. And my budget for consumable is 6. So let's go on the conservative side and say that a listener does not have CEREC. So 8% plus 6% is 14. But inevitably, other expenses creep up. It's expense creep. I don't know what it is. Maybe we're using the pillowy soft toilet paper. But let's add another 6% to make a round number of 20% overhead on our growth dollars. That means you keep 80% of your growth, 80% of that. So there's a way to grow and not have your overhead go up. So I just wanted to introduce that to our listener to understand that growth doesn't mean you have to have your overhead go up. You can be done strategically so that doesn't happen. Now, that $100,000 growth may not get you to the goal of 60% or less for your overhead. Remember that masterclass we have coming up?
Yes.
It's how to get your overhead to 60% or less. By the way, I'll put a pitch in here for our listeners. Come join us. It's August 25th. Specific plan to reduce your overhead to 60% or less, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern time. ThrivingDentist.com/masterclass. Now, it may not get you to 60%. But you're trending in the right direction. Now do it again. Grow another $100,000. And Naren, I'm going to go out on a limb and say every one of our listeners can grow $200,000 a year. Same team, same hours. Now, how can I say that so confidently? We've done it hundreds of times with our clients. Now, beyond that, and we may need to look at staffing. We may need to look at other expenses. But you know what? That top 160 to your net income, add that to what your current net income is, and we may be getting very close to that 60. We're certainly trending in the right direction.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the last question. I would like to grow my practice strategically by doing more specific services. For example, cosmetic dentistry and dental implants. What is the best way to attract these kinds of patients?
You know, that's a really great question because who needs more toothache new patients? I don't know. I mean, we're going to take care of them. Don't get me wrong. You know, we love the opportunity to help a patient get out of pain and develop a patient for life. You bet. But I don't know very many dentists that would sit down with me and say, Gary, I'd really like more toothache patients. Not so much. But you want to grow strategically. You want to grow on your high value services. And I think I heard you say, let me make sure I heard correctly. This particular doctor was interested in cosmetic dentistry.
Yes. Implants and cosmetic dentistry. He was interested in both.
Implants and cosmetic dentistry. Yeah. Great areas to grow on. And you know, the best way to do that today is digital marketing. People are looking for those services, and guess where they're looking? Go ahead, take as long as you like. Guess where they're looking? They're looking on Google.
Right.
They're looking on Google for, they may not know the term veneers, but they might want to say prettier smile.
Yeah. You know, and what we find is there are 50 to 100 terms just in cosmetic and another 50 to 100 just in implants, because, you know, some people even type in, you know, horror stories. They want to know what the worst thing could happen. You know, they might be typing in before and after. So they type in the zip code. They type in the city name. They type in all combinations of.
Well, and they use language that we would never use.
Exactly.
Because they don't know the dental terminology. Like, for example, I don't believe anyone in the dental profession would refer to a crown as a cap.
Yes.
And yet the public often uses that term. So, Naren, this is where you step in. This is where you and your team at Equa steps in. You can help a dentist develop a comprehensive digital marketing plan to not only attract more new patients, but attract more of the kind of patients they want. So you get to know that doctor, understand what their high value services are. In this case, cosmetic dentistry and dental implants. And then your goal is to work with that client to be found on page one of a Google search when someone in their community is looking for cosmetic dentistry and dental implants. And based on my experience, Naren, over 5 years of working with Equa, you guys get an A++ on the report card. We see 90 new patients on average every month. And most of those relate to our high value services, because like I said, we don't really want more new toothache patients. And as a result, we're able to grow strategically instead of just bodies, instead of just growth. And I would encourage, just like Naren, you suggested to our listeners that they want to learn more about coaching, to schedule a coaching strategy meeting. Our listeners can schedule a marketing strategy meeting with Lila Stone, your director of marketing, where Lila will do research on the practice, understand how the practice and the website looks in the eyes and mind of Google, and share with you a very specific plan for you to master the world of digital marketing. And the great news about it, Naren, is that it's very affordable. Naren, may I share your fees?
Absolutely, Gary.
You use a comprehensive, all-inclusive monthly service fee. It's $1,400 a month. It's $1,200 a month. I was thinking the annual expense. It's $1,200 a month, which is $1,400 a year. And for that, there's a myriad of services that are covered, but you'll essentially be found by mastering digital marketing. So patients in your community will find you for the services that you'd like to drive your practice to do more of. So that's really the action step I would suggest this doctor take, to schedule a marketing strategy meeting to learn how you can help them attract the strategic type of patients that they want.
Absolutely. That's the beautiful thing about Google and digital marketing. You can be very targeted. You can go after the exact people you want. And you can, like in your case, you are seen more than 100,000 times, or 480 search terms every month, which turns into 100 new patients calling your office. You know, so it's very easy to do. You just have to, you know, figure out the plan and then execute week after week.
Well, and I would amend that slightly. It's actually very difficult to do. But you have 14 teams, yes. 174 team members, yes. That are literally, Doctor, imagine the power of having 174 very specialized marketing experts working for your practice, and you not needing to pay their payroll. You write one check a month for $1,200. It covers everything they do. When you put it that way, it really is dentistry's best investment for sure.
Thank you, Gary.
Hey, as we come to the finish line, some thank yous are in order. I want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you. We've been achieving some record months in terms of downloads on the podcast. And we know that in part is from some of you sharing this with your colleagues. Thank you so much for all you do to help us grow. We love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show. We couldn't do it without you. If you're new and you want to help, three things you can do. You can talk to a colleague about the show. Tell them about it. Let them know they can download every episode. We're coming up on episode 500. I'll give a pre-plug for that. We're coming up on episode 500. And you're not going to want to miss that one for sure. But you can download all the episodes. They're free. iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, Apple Music, Amazon Music, wherever you get your podcasts. Second thing you can do is you can jump on iTunes and write a review. Reviews on iTunes help other dentists find us. And number three, you can hit the subscribe button. If you hit subscribe, that means every time we upload a new episode on Wednesday, it'll be automatically uploaded for your listening convenience. On that note, let me thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you we will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.